Hey, Dr. Neil Oza here from Ocean Point Dental Assisting Academy of Hammond. Just want to let you guys know our fall semester is starting pretty soon on August 22nd, and there's still time for early registration. Only a few spots available, so give us a call at 985-551-0329.
As Taylor said, my name is Kristy Miller, and I do work for the Office of the Governor, so I send greetings from the Governor. And as Taylor mentioned, I, as part of my job, represent five boards and commissions. And so that is over about 100 stakeholders. So that's including members and stakeholder groups across these five boards and commissions. And with the power of my boards and commissions, we are all drug policy focused. We really analyze the emerging trends in alcohol, tobacco, vaping, opioids, fentanyl, marijuana, you name it, and there's probably a task force looking into these issues. And so when Bridget asked me to come today and talk to you all a little bit about our office, but most importantly, about the topic of marijuana, I jumped at the chance. I've become a reluctant expert in this topic over the past, as Taylor said, I've been with the governor's office for about 5 years now, and but was starting to sort of come to this topic beforehand. So something I'll let you all know in case you don't. As of today, there are 19 states in the District of Columbia that have legalized marijuana for recreational use. 15 of those states legalized after 2016. So that's about 75% of them. So since 2016, it's been pretty much a fast and furious effort to legalize marijuana. And again, we're talking about marijuana for recreational use. So today I'm not going to really get into the benefits or concerns about medical marijuana. Truly, we're talking about recreational marijuana. But we're not talking about the recreational marijuana that you may think about and remember from the movie Dazed and Confused. We're not talking about the little leafy stuff that, you know, is grown, dried, rolled up in paper. We're talking about that, but we're also talking about very sophisticated forms of marijuana. We're talking about liquidized forms of marijuana, which can be used in vape pens and other e-cigarette devices. We're talking about butters. We're talking about shatter. I could blow your mind with the forms of marijuana that you may not know about. And while I won't get into that today, I did want to bring to your attention that the whole marijuana landscape has changed since the 1960s. And so, for example, I did some quick research because, again, I work for the governor's office. My role is to be a policy advisor. So I looked back at 2016, went to the legislature's website, did a quick bill text search. And in 2016, there were 14 bills filed in the legislature that had the word marijuana or cannabis in the bill text. And for those of you all who may not remember, 2016 was when the medical marijuana program was really being revamped and really coming online. So the vast majority of those bills were really focused on medical marijuana. Then I fast-forwarded to 2022 during this last legislative session. And I went back and looked, because though I track bills, I wanted to be sure I gave you the correct number. And there were 39 bills in 2022 that were filed that had the words marijuana or cannabis in the bill text. So that's 2.5 times more bills in just, what, 7 years? Yeah, math is not my strong suit. Policy advocacy is. But anyway, my point is that when I then reminded myself about the content of those 39 bills, I'm here to tell you all that the sort of overall frame of those bills was really different. Yes, there was an effort this past legislative session to overhaul our medical marijuana program, but there were just as many bills about recreational marijuana, about reducing additional penalties for marijuana, about not being able to search a person's home simply because of the odor of marijuana. And the sort of tone of the bills had really, really shifted. And so, meanwhile, when I look at the bills that I track and I see bills about vaping again and opioids and fentanyl and, you know, alcohol, and many of those are to tighten the restrictions around those substances or provide additional treatment efforts. Senator Mizell had a fantastic bill that got through that really is going to provide wonderful support for women who are using opioids and who are pregnant. So thank you very much for that legislation. But again, it's really started to focus legislation around restricting drugs, and that's drugs of all type. I mean, alcohol as well, that's grouped in, it is a drug, or providing good quality treatment and intervention. But the spirit, the context of so many of these 39 bills that were passed, that were filed this year, really, like I said, had a different frame of mind. And that's no doubt because our legislatures are really seeing and hearing about the ever-increasing normalization of marijuana across the country. And so they're thinking, if marijuana is being legalized across the country, why can't we do it in Louisiana? But I'm here to ask you all that we really need to hold the line and educate ourselves well on what today's marijuana is, what today's marijuana does, and what the harms of marijuana legalization look like. So during my time at the governor's office, like I said, I've become quite a bit of an expert on marijuana, so much so that last year there was a House resolution that was filed. And that House resolution said the legislature, specifically the House Criminal Justice Committee, would study this issue. It would study the impact of marijuana legalization. And they invited the governor's office, specifically me, who chairs the drug policy board for the governor's office, to serve on this committee. And that gave me the opportunity to really share with them research and information about the landscape of marijuana. And while I'm here to tell you, the media tends to portray it as, one, a cash cow, and two, not a really big deal because it's natural. I'm here to tell you the overwhelming research says opposite. I guess Bridget was so impressed with the issue brief that I developed for that House Resolution Committee. She included it in your packets. So if you want to become an expert on marijuana, you're welcome to check this out. There is an executive summary as well as some really good information. Obviously, there's not a lot of good information about Louisiana yet because we don't have it legalized. Though, again, Bridget has provided you great data about youth marijuana use in the state of Louisiana. And so check that out as well. It should be on your tables. But my point is that I just felt compelled to share with the esteemed legislators who served on this House committee the research about the negative impacts of marijuana legalization. Let me just read you a few. States with legal marijuana have among the highest rates of marijuana use in the country. And that's not just among youth, though youth rates are skyrocketing. That's among young adults. That's also among older Americans. Legal marijuana states have higher rates of marijuana-related driving fatalities. I know our executive director of the Highway Safety Commission is someone who is monitoring this closely. She's scared about THC, CBD, and medical marijuana's impact, you know, unintended impact on driving. Could you imagine if we had legal marijuana in the state of Louisiana with our already high car insurance prices, right? A few others, legal marijuana states have major issues with products that contain very high levels of marijuana. We're not talking 30% THC. That's the acronym for that really long word that marijuana has in it, the, you know, tetrahydrocannabidiol, right? It's not just 30%. We're talking 60 to 90% some of these high potency concentrated products have. Legal marijuana states have experienced more marijuana-related emergency department visits, hospitalizations, and accidental exposures. And this is accidental exposures of young children. We just had while it was a fentanyl-related, you know, overdose death of a young child, in states where we have legal marijuana, they are seeing similar non-fatal and fatal overdoses of young children whose bodies cannot handle high-potency marijuana. Just a few more. Legal marijuana states have seen increases in workplace problems, including labor shortages and accidents, because there are many jobs where you must pass a drug test to do that job. We're not just talking professional jobs, we're talking skilled labor jobs. And for a skilled labor state, could you imagine if we legalized marijuana for recreational use? Finally, legal marijuana states have seen it take longer than expected to meet original revenue projections, with many that still have not reached those levels. And relatedly, all legal marijuana states have seen public safety and social costs exceed revenue. If you've gone to the state of Colorado lately, it's a lovely state still, but the homeless rate is astronomical. People who come and think they're just going to come for a little while, they're going to partake, they're sort of tourists, they're marijuana tourists, they get addicted, they decide to live in Colorado, they can't find jobs, they become increasingly addicted, and then become homeless. And this is just one state. The state of California, with their wildfires, are seeing emergencies in their public land usage. The precious water that they need to fight forest fires can't be used because it's being redirected to marijuana farms. So it's a really serious issue. So while I'm talking about revenue, I'll kind of close with this. No state with a fully developed program, and again, states have only been legalized since 2012, with the majority having legalized since 2016. So not every state has a fully developed program. But there are a handful of states with a fully developed marijuana, recreational marijuana program. And for many of them, for most of them, their revenue projections haven't been fully realized, y'all. In Colorado, it took 5 years to reach their projected revenue. In year one of Massachusetts legalization, they didn't even get to half of their projected revenue. Meanwhile, there was a Centennial Institute in the state of Colorado that did a study looking at hard dollar revenue and public, you know, compared to public safety and social services costs. For every $1 of revenue, they found $4.50 had to be used to spend on public safety and social services costs. $4.50 to every $1. That would put us in the hole in this state. So I ask you all to not always just listen to messages about the will of the people. And that's because in 2016, when California passed their ballot measure to legalize recreational marijuana, they allowed for public opt-in or opt-out. So California had a ballot initiative. They approved legal marijuana with 57% of the vote, and that's of the people in the entire state of California. They immediately saw 80% of the municipalities in California say, not in my backyard. We're not gonna allow licensed marijuana businesses in our backyard. So 80% opted out of having marijuana businesses, which of course then crammed all of these businesses into other communities, causing major problems with, again, natural resources, with public safety, but also with a thriving black market or illegal market. So I didn't want to just bring you the problem without any solutions. My issue brief does talk about 5 solutions. There are things we can do at the local level. There are things we can do at the state level. Hopefully, Congresswoman Letlow will hold the line at the federal level in terms of not legalizing. But honestly, we have to be willing to talk about marijuana in our communities. We have to remind people, medical marijuana that has been studied well, that has been approved by the FDA and approved for certain conditions is fine, but one, you still shouldn't drive on it after using it. But secondly, we have to be willing to talk about recreational marijuana and how dangerous it is across our state and across the country. And so, like I said, there are other things that we can do. I'm happy to talk to you about local option if we ever get close. I know some of you may say this isn't a big deal for me because at the state level, it doesn't look like we're getting anywhere close. I can say with confidence, the Governor Edwards has continued to say, if a bill ever got to my desk, which I don't think one ever would, I would veto it. Hopefully that's a public safety and public health measure that you all could support, regardless of how you feel about the governor. But the governor won't be the governor forever, right? And so we have to continue to hold the line and be knowledgeable about marijuana for recreational use and its dangers to our community.
I'm Tanspo Parish Clerk of Court, Gary Stanga, and here's what our poll commissioners have to say.
I am a poll commissioner because it's an important part of the election process. It also gives me the opportunity to make relationships with people in the Clerk of Court's office and in my local community. And at the end of the day, I know that I've been an important part of this process.
I'm Rebecca Boris, Election Supervisor for the Tanspo Parish Clerk of Court's office. We need you as an election commissioner. Please visit our website at tangyclerk.org for more information.